Welcome back to Transcending Realities. Our guest today is Paul Davids, and to introduce him is Melinda Leslie.
Thank you, Lorianne. Paul, thank you so much for joining us here today. Paul and I have known each other for a long time, and we go back to the making of the movie, the Showtime movie, Roswell, when his beginning involvement in that, and someone I knew who was involved as an art consultant early on. And so, Paul,
That's about 20 years, 22 yeah. years, because yeah. Roswell came out in 1994.
Exactly, long time.
The one with Kyle MacLachlan is the way.
Well, Paul is here today to talk to us about his new book, this one right here, An Atheist in Heaven, that he co-authored with proclaimed and very recognized expert scientist in the paranormal, Gary Schwartz. And they did this project together. And it's mostly about that Paul and others were having contact from the late Forrest J. Ackerman. And those contact experiences, we're talking about spirit folks from the other side making contact, and the science behind what began a huge scientific investigation.
Because there was physical evidence.
And then that science investigation resulted in what was a two-part movie, the Life After Death Project, and then kind of putting the cart before the proverbial horse. After doing that, it resulting in then the book after the movies.
Right. Usually it's the other way around.
Yeah, yeah.
But in this case, so the movie came first as a natural byproduct of all the experiences that were happening after Fari passed away.
Yes.
You know, he was an atheist. People have said, are you the atheist? No. Forrest J. Ackerman, one of the founding fathers of science fiction.
Yes,
he was
yeah.
the atheist. And he said, but, you know, if I'm wrong about life after death, and I wake up to some great big party in the sky, he said, maybe when the party dies down and I've had my reunions with Boris Karloff and Bela Lugosi and all my friends of the horror and science fiction genres, maybe I would drop you a line.
Mm-hmm.
And then he said, but don't count on it.
Okay.
No, I didn't believe it.
Well, before you tell that story, because I have something I'm going to ask you about that specific thing, I want to inform our audience a little bit more about your background, just briefly. Paul is an acclaimed artist. He is an award-winning and equally acclaimed, very prolific author of many, many books, and very recognized and award-winning filmmaker, both producer and director of movies such as Showtime's Roswell, that we already mentioned, The Sci-Fi Boys, an equally amazing movie, Jesus in India, about the missing years of Jesus's life, and, of course, the Life After Death Project, this movie that we're talking about in conjunction with the book written about it. An amazing career that you have. I know I barely touched on it. But first off, Paul, I want to say I've followed your work, you know, for many years and seen most of your movies, very familiar with your work. And I feel without a doubt this new project and the book is the most important work you've ever done.
Well, I really appreciate that.
Thank you. Yeah.
It means a lot to me to hear you say that.
Well, yeah. I absolutely mean it. As someone who is, you know, and I'll come out of the medium closet real quick here, but I don't know if you knew that you know, he knows I live in Sedona, Arizona. And not only do I do UFO tours and whatnot, we'll talk about that more later, but I do mediumship rings. And before that, I was part of an investigative team for 15 years doing ghost investigations. So it's a subject very near and dear to my heart, and I apologize that you've come at it from such a scientific viewpoint, going after the real science, lab results, et cetera, that I know you'll get into. But in conjunction with what you just mentioned a little while ago, is I heard you in another interview say something that I thought was really, really amazing, that Forrest Ackerman was known for these play on words.
Yeah.
And that after he had said, I'll drop you a line, okay, one of his initial contacts with you was quite literally dropping you a line. Will you share that with us?
Yes. You know, he was a magazine editor, famous Monsters of Filmland magazine, my favorite magazine from the time I was a kid. Loved monsters. Loved science fiction. And he edited almost 200 magazines and a lot of books. So when he said, maybe I'll drop you a line, I didn't know I could take it that literally because, you know, just as I have this page I'm holding up here that has text on it, it all started for me about a week after the great tribute for him after he died. I was alone in our Santa Fe house. We have a vacation house. And I printed out a document I was going to review for tax purposes, sort of a log of business meetings, phone calls. And I was alone in the house. The doors were locked. I knew the document was fine. There was nothing strange about it. You know, no story here, folks, yet. I was out of the room for like 5 minutes in the bathroom. When I came back in, four of the words on the front page of the document were blacked out very neatly, precisely, targeted. You could tell those words had been selected, but there was nobody there. You know, this wasn't a drip from the ceiling. It wasn't a leaky pen in the bed. And it was still moist. It was impossible.
And it happened while you were in the bathroom?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah. I'd come back from a casino, and I always said, you know, sometimes those restaurants that give you such a bargain, a casino, not worth, not worth it. So I had to take a trip to the bathroom in my house. When I came out, my life changed because of this.
Sure.
I mean, really, I could never have foreseen that at that moment, that it was so important. But it was shocking. It was really quite terrifying. How would you feel when you know that there's nobody physically present that can do it? Mm-hmm. But it happened. So you've been a ghost hunter. I was not a ghost hunter. I've tried to be skeptical about all the subjects I've chosen, you know, whether it's UFOs or did Jesus go to India. I come at it always from the point of view of, you know, probably not. You know, we can. And even with the ink, it's physical evidence, but I got in touch with scientists, important chemists, and I took this to them. I wouldn't put it in a FedEx. It might disappear. I hand carried it. I flew. And that began a scientific study that was crazy. I mean, it just resulted in them becoming more and more confused, unable to replicate it, and then haunted. One of the scientists in particular, haunted.
Wow.
After getting involved, from the very first day he got involved, weird stuff started to happen to him. And, you know, the key thing I want everybody to know, not making it up, any of it. It's not exaggerated. It's not the product of imagination or invention. I wouldn't have gone there. With Fari, my friend, my dear friend for so many decades, who was an atheist, who said he didn't believe, I would never have proposed this if I didn't have any choice.
So. Why don't you ask Paul your question?
Oh,
because
yes.
I think it fits right in at this point.
Absolutely. Nice to meet you, Paul. And my question would be, your book is presented as both a personal story and a scientific study. So how can it be both?
A personal story and a scientific study. Well, it started as a personal story. It started as it was my relationship with Forrest J. Ackerman from the time I was 13 years old and was a kid who was a fan. And when he died, it was the personal story of attending the tribute with so many great people who paid homage to him, starting with Ray Bradbury, the writer who called Fari's house the Fort Knox of science fiction. And then the science came after. There was a reason to have science. There was physical evidence. You know, I've read books about with channeling, right? And I always say to myself, well, how do I know? How do I know this is coming from an Egyptian princess who, you know, lived
exactly.
How do I know it came from an alien on the planet Solaris, you know, which happens to be your name? You know, or with the reincarnation stories. You know, I kind of believe the ones where, you know, that happen in India, where there's a kid who can take you to the village she lived in the last life and introduce you to everybody and tell you what they did. Well, that's pretty convincing. But when somebody says, no, you know, I have a spirit guide, you know, who told me that, you know, I was present when Jesus was crucified on the cross. I saw that. Or, you know, I was in Napoleon's court. Or, you know, you got to say, oh, come on, why believe that? But here, where science takes over, where there's evidence, there's witnesses, there's many fields of knowledge that go into this. An atheist in heaven. Yeah. 160 items in the glossary of strange things that happened, witnessed by many people, studied by scientists. Sometimes these things happen in front of groups of people, usually referring back to Fari.
That is my question, just give us a little indication of some of the unexplained, bizarre things that happened. Just give us a few of those.
There are a lot of things that happen with ink, because, you know, it started with ink incident, and then there was a misprint in the story in Fate magazine about this, which again, it suddenly goes away from the text that was written and starts talking about the ink blot in my document, and nobody ever wrote that there. We've had the movement of a lot of masks, a lot of things having to do with masks. Fari was a collector of masks.
Uh-huh.
Strange electromagnetic fields, electronic voice phenomena happening around a mask. A mask that popped off the wall when I told a joke that Fari would have loved. Just happened right at the punchline.
Really?
Pops up in front of witnesses.
And not just down. I think I read that it went sailing across the room.
It went over a lampshade. That was, you know, a number of feet and landed at my feet.
Uh-huh.
Another one with a mask. I have a mask of Fari's face that I got at his estate sale. It was in his Acker mansion for many, many years. The day I heard, let me take this for a moment,
sure.
That the Life After Death project ended up on the Sci-Fi Channel. We didn't know it was going to get there, you know, as I'm making the movie. We had no idea how is it going to be seen by the world. But the day I got the phone call saying that they were going to accept it for the Sci-Fi Channel, there was nobody in the house, my house in L.A., when I went out to lunch. And I don't have open windows, or there's no wind blowing anything around. There's no way to explain why, when I got back, the mask of Fari's face had moved 10 feet across the room.
Uh-huh.
Nothing else moved.
That's wild.
I took pictures of it.
Wow.
And then immediately, computer phenomena. Mm-hmm. With the computer going down, I have like 15 hard drives. I have two screens. And when I boot back up, to have open folders that were not open before that deal with Forrest J. Ackerman. One whole screen has files about Fari, and the other about his magazine, Famous Monsters. I mean, yes, those folders existed in my
hard drive.
I didn't open them. I didn't open the photographic image that was on my screen when I came downstairs one morning after waking up and awakened my computer. And there, filling the screen, is a photo of Forrest J. Ackerman with a director who was his protege. He got started, Joe Dante. Why is the screen of showing the picture of, I didn't open it.
Yeah.
It keeps happening. You never know when to expect it.
Amazing.
Again and again and again. And for people that have read the book or seen the movie, Robert Egbie, a writer, saw the movie with a girlfriend. And when they were done, she started up her cell phone and she meant to press to check her emails, and she pressed navigation by mistake. So a map comes up on the screen, but it's not a map of where they are. It's a map 10 miles away that shows Ackerman Street, right in the middle of the screen.
Wow.
His name is Ackerman.
Yeah.
Wow.
His name Ackerman comes up as a CAPTCHA code to people
that
rapped on his script. His ring that he got from Bela Lugosi travels 4,000 miles from Los Angeles and ends up in Halifax, right next door to the director who rapped on his crypt on the day of his tribute.
Yeah.
Oh, my goodness.
160 items in an Atheist in Heaven. From all different fields. We have mediums. We
160
have
different confirming incidents. Items. Wow.
Oh, my.
Instrumental transcommunication, electronic voice.
So that would go wrong with my question.
Yes, exactly.
There's a lot of us that have long pondered the mysteries of life after death. And for those of us that really are connected with communicating with our deceased loved ones, and we know it's possible. So you just mentioned some really great things in your book. So we're interested in hearing more, but what would you say in your book that's different from others, besides for actual experience? Like you're literally talking about experiences that you've had.
Yeah, sure. Because a lot of people have written about life after death, and sometimes it's the near-death experience or reincarnation or channel, all different ways to talk about the subject. But because I got involved with scientists from the beginning, professors at three universities involved at their universities in this project. That would be Indiana University, Purdue University in Indianapolis, College of New Jersey, and University of Arizona, Tucson. So there's the science. And there's the fact that there's the consilience of evidence. The skeptics like to use that term.
Yeah.
It means that when science progresses, it's usually because experts in many different fields, it might be physics with biochemistry, an expert in archaeology, they all find something that all points to the same new discovery. And that's what we have here. We have a consilience from all these different fields of knowledge. Some of them, areas that some people would have questions about, like mediumship. Mm-hmm. But Gary Schwartz has spent 15 years vetting mediums.
That's true.
And separating the wheat from the chaff.
Mm-hmm. Which gave us the medium show.
Gary wrote a book called The Truth About Medium.
Yeah.
And he wrote The Afterlife Experiments and I think The God Experiments, but not God like creator. G period, O period, D period. Which was the guiding. G stand for the guiding influence behind all of creation. And I'm not going to remember the other two.
Sure, that's all right.
Directing. Well, directing.
I have a question. I got to ask you this.
Sure.
Before
it
just bursts out of me. Your co-author gave you a warning in the preface of the book. It's really unusual. What was it?
Well, it wasn't a warning to me. It was a warning to you, the reader.
Oh, okay. See, this is what I'm trying to figure out. I've seen the movie, but I haven't read the book yet.
Look,
so
Gary vetted me. When I first approached him, he didn't know that he could believe me or that I was being honest about this.
Sure. Mm-hmm.
And
one
strike I had against me is I am a member of the Magic Castle in Hollywood.
Ah,
it's been my hobby. I love prestidigitation.
Yeah.
And okay, but you know, weird stuff can happen to magicians too.
Mm-hmm. Yes, that's
and
right.
And I did an affidavit at the beginning of this swearing that this is true. Somebody wrote a review at Amazon saying, I don't believe it, he's a magician. You know, he's pulling our leg, he made it all up.
No.
It's gotta be a hoax.
Mm-hmm.
No, it's not a hoax. It's not a hoax. I swear to this as I would as if I was in front of a jury in a trial. It's true, these things happened. Mm-hmm. So what do we do with them? We need scientists to look at it. Mm-hmm. And we need to open our minds that this describes an afterlife where the personality of a man who I knew for so long, it's not just idle ghost hunting in a house where you don't know what spirit.
Right.
This is a man I knew.
Yeah.
And you mentioned he loved wordplay. Well, yes, and his sense of humor keeps showing up in these different things that he does.
It sounds that
it's like his calling card.
Mm-hmm.
He's telling us he's still here. He didn't believe. Gary entitled one chapter, Can an Atheist Change His Mind After He Dies?
Yeah. Apparently so.
Apparently so.
Yeah, apparently, you know. We're going to have to get that chapter to my dad before he passes over. One of the things that my dad and I have, he's a total atheist.
All right.
And I said the same thing to him. I said, when you go, you got to come back and you got to tell me you're okay because I know you're going to come back.
Yeah.
He goes, you're just so full, you know, whatever.
Yeah, find something to agree on.
So I'm going to give him this book.
Look, I think I guess everybody has their own opinions about it. Some people are very, very close-minded. They're totally atheistic. They don't. But this isn't an argument about atheism, about God, or even heaven. We used heaven in a very broad sense in our title, An Atheist in Heaven. It just means we have a spirit, and the spirit evolves into somewhere when we change form. Where that is, we don't know. I've come to conclude, in my own personal opinion, that it's right here.
Oh, yeah. Mm-hmm.
It's right, you know, like Jesus said, heaven is among you or it's within you.
Absolutely.
Yes, sure, absolutely.
It's right here. And you know what reinforces my belief about that? You get into an elevator with your cell phone, all right? You can make a call and you're in a box of solid steel.
Yeah.
Right.
But there's wavelengths of information
that
are going right through the steel.
Oh, sure.
You've got television waves on all these different channels, radio waves, all these frequencies all around us going right through our bodies from every direction throughout the entire Earth. So why not existence in another realm right here?
Frequency.
Well, that's what they found.
An intelligent frequency by which, you know, the Hindus call it the astral body. We leave the physical body, then the astral body. So whatever you want to call it.
Mm-hmm.
I think what the book does is it will, for those who are on the borderline, it'll give them a lot of ammunition for believing, yes. And for the scientific minded, it will challenge them because they have to get past what the chemists say here.
Sure.
Yeah.
About
sure.
the ink.
Mm-hmm.
Why a 3-year study? Why unable to reproduce it?
That's
right. Why phenomena? Witness phenomena, some of it photographed on film, happening to the main scientist, the chemist, who's spearheading that research.
Mm-hmm.
So if they're going to be intellectually honest, they have to deal with it. They can't just say, oh, well, he's a member of the Magic Castle, so sure, he made the whole thing up. Sure. Couldn't have. Couldn't you deal with the evidence that's there? No. This didn't originate with me. Yeah. It originated outside of me, and I think with him, the man who's...
Yeah. Well, that's... And Paul, that's exactly why I think this is such an important book and this new work that you're doing. It's not just about communicating with the afterlife. I mean, like I said, I do that as a medium. It's about the evidence, and it's about doing some real science that you bothered to get involved with Gary, and that you guys contacted labs and scientists and did this kind of work to say, okay, what is really going on here? And can we, you know, prove it, you know? And to me, that's what makes it so important, is that you've made that statement about it in a book, and you guys, you know, they're presenting all their documentation and evidence in this book. I understand what it's like, 513 pages or something?
Yeah, don't let that scare you, because there's a lot of photos.
Yeah,
oh,
yeah,
great.
And this.
I like that.
You'll get the whole history of Fari and his Acker Mansion, you know, and his love of monsters.
But my point being that you've included all that evidence.
Yeah.
And again, I think it's just amazing, and thank you so much for doing it.
Yeah, and also, people should watch this first, then read the book. That's my opinion. What do you think?
Well, you know, I made the movie first. That takes you up to 2013. The book takes you up to 2016.
Oh, wonderful.
You know,
the reason
there's a book is because when the movie was done, Gary Schwartz was getting calls from people in the academic community he knew who said, Gary, you know, the documentary was nice, but it's not enough for us. You know, if you want it really taken seriously by your colleagues, you need to put it all down. You've got scientific reports. Let's see them. You know, you've got evidence and documentation. Give us chapters. Give us a glossary. Give us an index. Let us study it. So Gary kept asking me again and again, Paul, we got to do this. We got to do it for Fari. And I kept saying, yes, Gary, I agree. Yes, yes. And 6 months later, yes, Gary, I agree. I said, I yes'd him to death. The expression means is you really mean to do it, but you know, life gets in the way. But then it started. We documented everything. You know, it took 3 years to put it all down.
Wow,
that's amazing.
That's amazing. Mm-hmm.
So, Lars, do you have another question?
Actually, I think it kind of dovetailed into what Sky was talking about, but insofar as the illusion of death, which to me is an illusion, it would be a state of consciousness and a progression beyond the illusion of space and time. So how do you define that transition? I mean, how do you define consciousness in general?
How do I define consciousness? I think Descartes tried to do it. Was it Descartes who said, I think, therefore I am?
That's so, pretty much it.
So, you know, we're...
I'm not sure who said it, but I think
we are conscious beings who know that we are impermanent. Mm-hmm. We know about death. We share the planet with millions of animals who don't know that they're going to die, that they're not going to... I assume that. Maybe instinctually, when the tiger starts to pounce on an antelope, the antelope knows he's in big trouble.
Yeah, he gets clued in.
pretty quick.
But we know something about our history, the history of the human race, what great things from the past have been left behind for us to study now. Civilizations come, they go. And for each one of us as an individual, we arrive, you know, as a baby. None of us too spectacular at that point, right? Mm-hmm. Crying, needing to be helped with every single thing we do. And a lot of us end up that way at the end of our life, helpless.
Yes, that's true.
You know, and in the middle, there's this egotistical, excited existence where many of us convince ourselves we know everything. It's where you are shocked into realizing that you haven't got a clue that life starts, as far as I'm concerned. The day the inkblot happened for me was a really, really important day, because I couldn't ignore it. Mm-mm. If I had been inattentive, I might have just taken the piece of paper and said, oh, it got ruined. I got to print it out again.
Yeah.
You know, and then that's the end of it.
Right. Yeah. Wow.
But if you pay attention,
yeah,
if you're really aware of the subtle things that are happening in your life, because a lot of this communication, we say the other side, whatever that means, with the spirit world, it's subtle.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
It's subtle. It might be the butterfly that landed on one of my actor's shoulders and just stayed there and then kept coming back, and he got a photo taken of himself like this with the butterfly, and then later discovered there had been a painting made of his retarded brother going like this with a butterfly.
With a butterfly.
Shoulder.
Perfect.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, that's perfect.
We call it synchronicity.
Yes.
Oh, that's amazing.
That's one thing I know you've talked about in the book so much is the synchronicities. I think you said, what, 160? How many synchronicities?
Well, no, there's 160 incidents we talk about.
Okay.
Of those, I'm saying about 100 of them probably relate to Fari.
Okay.
But there are many synchronicities, and the skeptic likes to say, okay, coincidence. Mm-hmm. Mere coincidence.
Yeah.
They love the word mere.
Yeah.
To diminish it, right?
Yeah.
Never mind that statistically it's off the charts, so it's nothing mere about it.
You know, and things that are statistically off the charts do happen every day, so
yes.
We have to start admitting that.
Yes.
Probability theory, you know, how many people are going to get struck by lightning today?
Yeah.
We hope it won't be.
Yeah.
You, but some it's going to happen to somebody. Mm-hmm. Somebody's mm-hmm. going to win the lottery. Mm-hmm. So the things that are off the charts, they'll happen.
Yes.
But what happens when you've had a friend who recently died who said he'd contact you, and one thing happens, and then another.
Yes.
And another, and another, and another. And it keeps mm-hmm. going on and on and on, so that the very license plates on the cars that swerve yes. in front of you suggest his name.
Yes, exactly.
Sure. Yeah.
You know,
he's
exactly right.
So I wanted to ask you, do you have any witnesses to this? And if you did, what did they think?
There were witnesses to, again, some of it. Enough of it. Really enough of it. And what did they think? Most of my witnesses were skeptics at heart.
That's what I was
who were
that was intentional.
Who would sort of pat me on the shoulder and say, yes, Paul, another one. But then when it would happen, there was one that I went up to Fari's crypt and was leading two guys who knew him. They didn't know where the crypt was. You have to know, we talked about his wordplay. His name was Forrest. Fori. But he went by four, the number 4E. That's the way he would write his name many, many times. And he was the expert of promoting film special effects. Mm-hmm. And in the business, that's FX.
Okay. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
I had a broken leg at the time, and I was using Fari's cane. I didn't know then it had a serial number that began with 084. But I'm driving up to the crypt, leading these guys, and a van swerves in front of me, and it leads the way to the crypt as though it was deliberately leading us there, this white van, and it parks right before the last left-hand turn. And I stop the car, and the guys got out of their car, and I put it at the license plate, and it said 4EFX.
Oh, my God. Oh, my God.
No way.
And the numbers were 084, and I discovered later when I got home and I picked up his cane, you know, because I had a broken ankle at that time, that it began with 084, the number on the cane I'm walking with.
Yeah.
That's wild.
He was the editor of Famous Monsters. We called it FM, Famous Monsters.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
And he was the Acker Monster.
Mm-hmm.
You know, that's and he was AM.
Yeah.
Right before that mask moved 10 feet in my office that mm-hmm. I told you about when I was out for lunch
yes,
there.
Yes, yeah.
And I got pictures of this in the book. A car swerved in front of me with a license plate that said, AM loves FM.
Oh, my God.
Aww.
Oh, my God.
Oh, my goodness.
It's just remarkable. And, you know, and credit to you for paying attention. I think a lot of people have communication from their loved ones on the air side and don't pay attention to these little subtle things that start to add up.
Yeah.
That are actually more commonplace than I think people realize.
Absolutely.
When you talk to people, I've talked to so many people in making the movie of the Life After Death Project about, has this happened to them? Mm-hmm. Was there a mother or a brother or a sister or somebody they were close to, do they think they've heard from mm-hmm. this person after they passed? And my wife did this too, just asking everybody, telling them what we were doing, and it was about 50% of the mm-hmm. people we talked to.
Yeah,
that's a lot.
Said, that's
you know,
actually a lot, yeah.
Mm-hmm. I believe in that because you know I heard from my mother. You know, her favorite scent was lavender, and I was in the room when she passed away, and suddenly the whole room was filled with the scent of lavender.
Exactly.
So
when you're sending out a communication signals and you see something that appears on a license plate, what is it about you that makes that so connected and so special? Is it your heart energy? Why is it that this appears for you. And this is so real. I mean, this is actually having things come from another dimension into our 3D reality and making it real.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's a good question, and it's a complicated one, because it does go toward, you know, the very theme of this show, transcending mm-hmm. realities.
Absolutely.
Because we all have mm-hmm. a ground reality of what we think is real, and then mm-hmm. we discover there's so much more of it we don't know. Animals are able to pick up things out of range of our visual or auditory
exactly.
abilities. So there are, and there are all these signals that are coming all the time from everywhere that have to be decoded by our instruments, whether it's a telephone or a computer. Mm-hmm. So there's a lot of information out there. Now, how is it possible that while I'm visiting somebody's crypt, a license plate shows up on a van right in front of me that has very, very
yeah.
strong connection to that individual? I don't think you can think about it logically at that point. In other mm-hmm. words, a ghost didn't change the license plate on
sure.
the car and
yeah.
plant that
yeah.
car to be there or get me stuck in traffic so that I'm 5 minutes late, so I'm there right in time for the van, coordinating mm-hmm. it all. I don't think you can look at it that way. It's just, you know the song, Row, Row, Row Your Boat Gently Down the Stream.
Of course.
Merrily, yeah. merrily, merrily, life is but a dream.
Life is but a dream, yeah.
And someone once said, life resembles much more a great thought than a great machine. There's thinking going on that's way beyond us and outside of us. And how it all fits together, we can't use our rational minds to
yeah.
dissect it or put the pieces together. We can only experience it and know that, like the movie Inception, a dream within a dream
oh,
within
right,
a dream.
Right. Yeah. Amazing.
That all these things are connected pieces of like one vast jigsaw puzzle, and we're only seeing a very small part of it most
yeah.
of the time.
Yeah. I want to ask Laura something about this, because this brings up the AI system that we were talking about previously about mind control.
Right.
So this is very interesting because, you know, do they cross over together? I mean, are they the same thing?
Right. Well,
what's
I think they correlate because everything's about, we were talking about consciousness, but it's about, you set the intent. You're focusing on certain things, whether it's a person or whatever it is. You're creating a fabric in the continuum, so it is manifesting on one parallel dimension or another.
Oh.
So that's just my take on it. That's my own impression. But I do see the artificial intelligence array systems, and I'm familiar with the covert technology. That's another story. But literally, there is I believe there's an intelligent life and an intelligent design and network to what we experience from day to day. I believe there's a false matrix, and then there's a higher matrix that we can create through consciousness mm-hmm. and higher states of evolution. So that's my own impression. I'd like mm-hmm. to know what yours is.
Well, and you just addressed something which is known in scientific experiments and whatnot, particularly paranormal ones, that the viewer affects the experiment.
Mm-hmm.
That you
exactly.
become part of the equation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
So you're part of the equation in witnessing those things happening, or anybody is.
That's right.
And yeah. and mm-hmm. it does. It makes us really question the entire nature of reality itself and how things interflow and work and relate to one another. And I think it's proof that it is such an interconnected system in what's happened. You give a quote, Paul, I'm trying to remember it exactly, something Gary Schwartz had said about materialistic science. Well, this is post-materialist. Yeah.
He likes that expression,
yeah.
post-materialist science.
Fine.
Because
yeah,
materialist science dismisses all of this. It's just
yeah, absolutely.
Not on their
mm-hmm.
charts.
Mm-hmm.
They'll tell you there's no evidence without looking at the evidence. You know,
yeah. So. Without having the evidence in their hand, in other words. Mm. Yeah.
And it's coming to a whole new understanding of the very nature of reality to say that we interface with all these energetic worlds, which is mm-hmm. just what you were talking about.
Mm-hmm. Right, right, mm-hmm. right.
Exactly. It's all intelligent.
Well, when you think about it, the whole history of civilizations has been trying to tell us that mm-hmm. from the days
yeah.
of the ancient
exactly.
Egyptians,
yeah.
the
yeah.
Romans,
absolutely.
The Greeks,
yes.
they all had
absolutely.
Their seers, yeah.
they
had
they
their
did.
Prophets, they put importance in precognitive dreams,
mm-hmm.
it was all part of their reality. They told mm-hmm. us there were angels.
We've been prevented from having this information intentionally, but it's been mm-hmm. there.
Yeah, that's
yes.
true.
Except twisted and turned and...
Well, it's belittled. It's called, it's just considered, you know, mythology.
Or religion. I was
it's
just going to bring up religion
yes.
because they give it to us in pieces in religion. You know, as long as you only get this much information, they'll never really figure out what's going on,
right.
is my opinion about
control.
Religion.
You know, that goes to that other movie I made that you mentioned,
yeah.
Jesus in India.
Yeah,
exactly.
Like leaving out.
There's 18 years of the life of Jesus that are not mentioned
yeah.
in the New Testament. Only
yeah.
one sentence about them.
Yeah,
that's
age
right.
13. To 30.
Yeah.
It's
yeah.
a pretty big gap.
That's amazing.
Where'd he
you know,
go?
I come from the film business. And we have an expression called jump cut. Do you know what a jump cut is?
Yes, yeah,
exactly.
Yeah. Something's going on in your story, and then you cut, you know, and then 18 years later, you pick it up again. You know, that's a pretty big gap. Mm-hmm. Most jump cuts, you know, are 30 minutes.
Yeah. Or he had lunch,
and then we pick him up at his girlfriend's house.
Yeah.
So I thought, well, that's a mystery, and with author Ed Martin.
Yeah,
Ed's wonderful.
Based on his book, King of Travelers.
Oh, yeah.
We went to India for 6 weeks. We traveled 4,000 miles across the country. We went to all the great Hindu temples. We talked to the Shankaracharya, the like equivalent of the Pope of Hinduism. Mm-hmm. You know, the Dalai Lama in Dharamshala. I went to the Vatican and spoke to Monsignor Corrado Balducci.
Yeah,
Was an exorcist for the Vatican.
Yeah.
An apostolate nuncio.
Yeah.
I talked to the top biblical scholars, including Elaine Pagels at Princeton. So
this
is the way I tackle the scene. You got a mystery?
Yeah.
You got a question?
Yeah.
Let's really dig in the facts. You know, I have a question.
And it speaks to what they were just saying about information being kept from us in that way, because certainly those missing years of Jesus was kept from those, like Ed Martin in his own upbringing as a Baptist. I think
they lost the appropriate manuscripts.
Yeah, yeah.
Like, and they've lost a lot of the moon photos.
And when he can't find them. Imagine that,
What were you going to say, Amisha?
Well, I wanted to know, as maybe you've probably done some talking to mediums or something about this whole project, did anyone get any messages, audible messages? Would you tell us about those?
Yes. I mean, see the movie, because I filmed the mediums. These were the handpicked mediums from Gary Schwartz.
Mm-hmm.
The ones he felt that really had an ability.
Mm-hmm.
So one of them is a Catherine Yunt in Tucson. Another is an Israeli psychic, Orit Ish-Yemeni Temer.
That's right, yeah.
And they were told absolutely nothing. They were told, we've got a gentleman who would like to come with a camera. Can he do a video camera? We're not going to tell you his name.
Right.
And then when I get there, they say he would like to hear from a deceased friend of his named Forrest.
Mm-hmm.
Possible. And what flowed out of those two in particular was absolutely astonishing.
I mean,
you had to say, there was so much detail. You had to say at the end of it, he's at their shoulders whispering in their ears.
Mm-hmm.
There's just no way to grasp, you know, how they come by those specific
knowledge.
Oh, this
goes back to what you were talking about being in the elevator. Remember about the cell phone?
Yes.
They're just picking up on the cell phone signal from the other side better than I do.
They have the ability to decode. Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Exactly.
Something happened to me on a show the other day, on a radio show, that really spun me around. And it goes with this thing like the license plates and, you know, these things that just happen that connected. And who makes it happen that way? The studio manager, the producer, and the moderator of the show swore that they had nothing to do with what happened during the show. As a matter of fact, they didn't even notice it. But what happened was, when we went to the first commercial break, after talking about Forrest J. Ackerman, the first commercial begins, "Come into the forest."
Oh, my.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah.
It's closer than you think.
Yeah.
In the forest, you will discover the you that you never really knew was there.
Yeah.
Brought to you by the National Forest Service.
Yes.
They didn't plant it there.
And Paul, I think the point being, it shows that there is this interconnectedness between all things. And I think what you've done in this book and the whole project is you've shown that interconnection, and then you've backed it up with science and data to support it. But it's the bigger message is the fact that, as we said, the viewer affects this experiment, that there is, that everything has a connection. And it's not just force coming through, it's the universe coming through to say this exists, and that the afterlife exists as a very real thing.
That's right.
And I agree with that. I think that's true. And the mediums say the more I focus on it, the more they're responding in kind.
Well, now that makes me wonder if you aren't a battery for it, that you aren't kind of like the impetus for everything to be happening.
Especially because you were a magician. My father was a magician, and there was always this kind of mediumship in my home. And you, I believe, would be a real good frequency connection for him.
You know how I feel about that? With all my years of having been a member of the Magic Castle, I've seen so many shows. Professional stage magic is, there's no mediumship involved.
No.
It's all a deliberate deception.
Yes, it is.
It's a misdirection.
Misdirection, yes.
And then you, as the magician, you enjoy seeing that your viewer has been pleasantly deceived into thinking that something impossible happened when it didn't. So I'm accused now. You can go to Amazon and see my main accuser.
He's
a magician. We can't believe what he says. But here's the point. I'm now the victim. I'm the victim of the magic of the universe.
I'm the one
that the tricks are being played on.
Yes.
And
but
it's,
Paul?
It's a fact.
Mm-hmm.
Paul? I'm not initiating it. I stumble. And these things are, they happen and I notice.
But I think that's just the universe keeping you humble.
What's the matter? You think my head has got a little smaller?
No.
Do you still connect with Forrest?
Oh, yes. Do I connect with him? Oh, yes. Absolutely. Absolutely. I connect with him through my ceiling fans.
And
explain that, please. I'm lost with that one.
We built a new kitchen, a wonderful new kitchen. And it has two ceiling fans, and they have lights. They'll go on by themselves at different times.
Oh, yeah.
And they never go off by themselves.
Okay.
And at one point, I said to my wife, you know, maybe it's picked up some signal in the atmosphere or whatever. Well, who knows? Yeah. Maybe it's Fari.
Yeah.
But let's have a code system. Let's call this the good news fan.
Oh, good.
So if there's something good going to happen, Fari.
Yeah, yeah. There you go.
Yeah. Uh-huh.
Make that fan go real fast, Fari. And that's the bad news fan. So if something, we better watch our back.
Yeah.
You
mm-hmm.
know, we might think everything's okay, but maybe it isn't. You know, spin that fan, and if we're in big trouble, Fari, turn on the light too.
Okay. Oh, wow. I like that.
So this has been going on now for a couple of years since we built the kitchen. Happens all the time. The fans always get it right.
Seriously?
Oh, my God.
Have you been keeping a tally?
The correlation, not the tally that Gary Schwartz wanted me to take. He wanted me to write them all down.
Yeah.
But I'm tired of writing it all down.
Yeah.
But, yes, there is a connection, and particularly when after, it was a month or so, nothing had happened with the fans. I said to my wife, you know, the fans have, you know, they've stopped. You know, maybe this means we're not going to hear from Fari anymore.
Mm-hmm. Oh. Mm-hmm.
Later that afternoon, come downstairs and the good news fan is going.
No, it's still there.
You know?
Hey,
so it's delightful when you're dealing with a ghost who is a friend. What could I say?
Yeah, that's wonderful.
Or a loved one.
And he knows your sense of humor, and you know his. So a lot of it's like the inside track, the inside joke between you.
Yes.
But I think it shows, again, you know, that it's him coming through repeatedly to say, not only I'm here, but that there is this other dimension, and it's part of our lives.
Absolutely.
And he has now learned that, and then one of you had said about him being like the messenger, that this is now, you know, that this is your path now, is to make this so and get this information out and be the conduit. And I think it's Forrest working through you, or the other side, the universe, as we said, the whole picture working through you to show that it isn't just Forrest, it's the interconnectedness to all things.
You got it right on. And you know who agreed with that, because in the course of the interviews I did, I spoke to Richard Matheson before he passed away, writer, great writer.
Mm-hmm.
Look him up if you don't know his works, but he did write What Dreams May Come.
One of my favorite movies. I think it's so accurate.
And Robin Williams was in that, but that was about the afterlife, and his afterlife was individually tailored for him. And Richard Matheson, I went to him and told him of the phenomena, and he knew Fari. Fari had promoted his science fiction films going back to The Incredible Shrinking Man and The Twilight Zones.
Wow.
He wrote them all.
That's right. Mm-hmm. Yeah,
So Richard Matheson said, no, I absolutely think that Fari is in touch with you, and he's correcting himself.
Mm-hmm. Oh, sure.
You know.
Yeah. He's saying, I admit I was wrong.
Yes.
Yeah, admitting it with a big smile. And one of the mediums was actually Catherine Yund. In the middle of her mediumship, she looked at me and she says, "He thinks you're too serious, Paul."
Oh, does he?
Oh, wow.
Afari, he always had a joke at the tip of his tongue.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know, it was, did you know that Kraft cheese is actually expanding to the Holy Land? Yeah, they're going to be coming out with Cheeses of Nazareth. Or, he loved that one. Did you hear about the dyslexic,
that one's good.
The dyslexic drunk who walked into a bra?
No.
Or the cross-eyed teacher. She couldn't control her pupils.
Okay.
Oh, yeah. Always had that kind of up on me. Did you know about the restaurant they built on the moon? Very good food, but no atmosphere.
Yeah.
So this was Fari. He was always, you could be very serious, you could be in a dour mood, you could be very worried, and he always had just that recipe, and it was always humor.
That's wonderful.
Well, I expect absolutely when wonderful. You go home today, your good news fan is going to be spinning away.
I'm ready for it. Yeah.
And you know, with the mediums, did any of the mediums, did they tell you what it might be like over there? Did he give an opinion of what was going on over there? Or
no.
How he liked it or anything?
No, he did. And you know, Fari wrote a long essay, which I published in An Atheist in Heaven. It was 1 year from when his wife died.
Mm-hmm. Oh,
and
wow.
It began sort of, well, Wendy, it's been a year, you know, since your heart stopped beating and you left me, and so you know by now what we always said, there is no afterlife. That's what we call an oxymoron.
Yeah.
It's like saying an atheist in heaven. They don't go together, really, they clash.
No.
So,
yeah.
But he went on and on and on in this essay about why he didn't believe in an afterlife, that, you know, God couldn't keep track of all the problems with all the lovers and the people that have had seven wives and six husbands, and they all meet up there, and who's with who, and you know, and mixing Saddam Hussein, and well,
yeah,
he
well, this just, I got to ask you this: his wife never contacted him.
Well, he certainly never
or he
indicated.
Didn't notice. He didn't have the frequency ready to accept that she might have been trying to talk to him.
No.
Okay. When they moved to John Hall's house that became the Acker Mansion, John Hall was an actor, played Ramar of the Jungle.
I don't know that one.
It was a TV series. Well, they certainly heard the story about how the portrait of John Hall had fallen off the wall the day he died.
Mm-hmm. Right. Oh.
And he did collect a lot of, you know, strange stories like that he would tell, including one involving his grandfather, who was an architect who got the assignment to design the Bradbury Building in Los Angeles.
Oh, yeah.
That has been used in a lot of science fiction.
Yes, sure.
Blade Runner.
Oh, yes.
Sure.
And his grandfather was very insecure about taking the assignment because he wasn't fully commissioned yet as an architect. He was a junior guy in the firm, but the guy that wanted to commission the building saw his doodles of futuristic things and said, "Hey, that's the guy I want." Mm-hmm. So they asked a Ouija board. His maternal grandparents.
Oh, his grandparents.
I got you. Okay.
Yes,
they asked a Ouija board, you know, should the grandfather, you know, take the assignment?
Oh, wow.
And the Ouija board said, "Take the Bradbury Building and you will succeed." Mm. Spelled backwards and upside down. And, and Fari kept that piece of paper of the Ouija reading framed. And so this is the oxymoron again. This is the guy that doesn't believe in any of this.
And yet
if you're taking a tour through the house, he'll say, "Oh, and by the way, you know, this is..."
And Paul, this is interesting because yet he collected these things, he knew these stories, he shared these stories.
There was
a part of him that really knew. Those protest too much, you know?
He had a chair that Abraham Lincoln had sat in his house because several grandfathers ago, Fari, the grandfather, had photographed Abraham Lincoln in that chair.
Wow, that's really cool.
And this chair was in the Acker Mansion, and you take the tour and you go by, and Fari says, "You know, you better look twice because some people have seen Abe's ghost sitting in that chair." But of course he says it in the sense of humor, right? But what is there beneath the humor?
Exactly, that's
exactly
my point.
Exactly.
That there was something deep in his subconscious or in his consciousness,
you know,
that always, he was open to it.
There's always a wink, and you know, on the cover of the book, the expression,
shh,
beside me. Quiet, you'll hear the children of the night. And when I was making the final version of the movie for broadcast and outputting it, it takes 10 hours to render it.
Right.
I lost the soundtrack in the middle of the movie. It went completely silent for half the movie, and I checked, where did it go silent? Exactly when the man who was at his side when he passed away, a friend of his named Earl Rossell, was talking about this silence gesture from this painting as being by L.J. Dopp, by L.J. Dopp, this gesture being like the silence of death.
Oh.
And at that point, we lose sound.
Oh, isn't that interesting?
Wow.
That's amazing.
That's extremely interesting. There you go again.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
You know? Again, it's not only, it's teaching you, yes, about the reality of the afterlife, but it's also teaching you about the reality of existence itself, and it's amazing.
So I've talked about being a magician and my love of the magic castle, and I particularly favor mentalism as a type of magic, which is to perfectly create the illusion that I'm reading your mind. Mm-hmm. I met an author named David Steele. His book, Fatal Sins. Psychics all the way through this book. It's about 300 pages. You can see it's a novel.
Sure, yes. Uh-huh.
It's a regular novel, and it's 280 pages. Mm-hmm. And he said, it's not just the psychics in the story that have reality to these things, but the book itself has extraordinary property. So let me ask you, just say stop anywhere.
Stop.
Right there?
Yeah.
You want this page or this page?
I want that page.
Okay, find a large word on that page. You know, not a little word like somebody picks again or radio.
Let me see.
Find a large word on that page and don't tell me what it is.
You okay.
Got it?
Got it.
You remember it, okay? Solaris, right? Mm-hmm. All right, tell me when to stop. Okay, you got your finger on the page?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, which page, this or this?
This
okay,
one.
A large word.
Okay.
You remember it.
Mm-hmm.
You did find one already?
Yes.
Okay, not a puny little word like radio.
It's a good one.
You got a good one. Okay, and Misha. Mm-hmm. Misha, tell me when to stop.
Here.
You got your finger there?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, which page is it gonna be, this or this?
It's gonna be this side.
Oh, you need your glasses?
I need my glasses.
I can't see through this book.
I can't see.
Not yet.
I have it.
You got a word. All right, so I'd like you all to concentrate on your word.
Mm-hmm.
I think somebody's got a word that either begins with V or the first letter of the word rhymes with V. Who would that be? It's not you? Mm-hmm. None of you. Wow, I'm striking out right from the beginning. Uh-huh. That's okay. I can kind of. Well, so what was the first letter of your word?
I was supposed to tell you?
Yeah.
C.
Well, rhymes with V. That's what I just said.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Yeah,
I thought you said V.
No, I was picking it up from you. No, I said it's either V or it rhymes with V. Okay. What was your first letter?
N.
Okay. I'm feeling that yours has something to do with information. You might read it.
Good.
Something you're reading it. From you, I'm getting illumination of some kind.
Very good.
But it's an object. But the object itself doesn't cause the illumination. But it's connected with it in some way. What was your first letter?
E.
Yours was E. So another one that rhymes with V.
Oh, I'm sorry. Right? It did, didn't it?
Right. So now, I think that yours, it's something that you might get by prescription, but not necessarily medicine. I'm going back to yours, and I definitely think there's paper involved. Yours, I'm feeling silver. It doesn't have to be made of silver, but your word is candlestick.
You're good.
I think that you're looking at me funny through those eyeglasses. Your word is eyeglasses.
It is.
And your word, Misha, is newspaper.
Amazing, yes.
Yay!
Yay! That is wonderful!
That's great.
Okay, now here's the thing I want to say about this. What you've just seen is a magic act.
Wow.
That's called mentalism, magic. That was not real mind reading.
Sure.
The point I want to make is that skeptics have said, you can't believe this man when he's telling you about all these things that have happened because he does things like this mentalism for entertainment. Mm-hmm. What I'm saying is, first of all, it's true, all the things that I've said. It's not my magic. It's the magic of the universe. It's the magic. Mm-hmm. And I haven't invented it or sought these things. They've happened. They've sought me. So there's a difference. The paranormal can even happen to members of the Magic Castle.
And in the beginning of the book, Paul, you have a sworn affidavit that everything you're presenting there.
Yeah. You know, and the skeptics say, oh, you can tear up that affidavit. Well, no.
There's a reason you put that affidavit in there.
I swear it on the grave of my parents. The things that are in this book that I say happened to me, they happened. I haven't invented them. Whereas this little act of mentalism you just saw,
it was impressive. Yes, it was.
Thank you for being with us.
It was very good, and we enjoyed it.
Yeah. Thank you for being with us, Paul. We really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
That was great.